Thank you. shared issue and to have you speak a little bit later. This morning, I was reading Facebook, and once in a while there's something really good that comes on, and I thought, read this little thing that Sweeney said. If you leave everything in the hands of God, you will see the hand of God in everything. That was a good thought for the day. Let us begin our service by to add her to our prayers. The storm family and the passing of Jim Storm. Storm family and the passing of Jim. Well, let us go to God in prayer. We'll have a few minutes or minutes of silent meditation, and then I'll lead us in our morning prayer. Oh God, we give you praise and glory for your great creation that you have allowed us to live in. We consider you an awesome God for blessings and opportunities. We give thanks for a place to come to worship, where we are free to worship, where we can think of you, study your word, hear your gospel. Give thanks for all the blessings, for the abundance that we have, for our shelters, for our food, for family and friends, and for our church. We are thankful that we do have this place to worship. We pray that you will guide our people here, that we might continue to serve you, that we might seek to grow and to bring others into your house so that they can worship and know you and know the love that you have given to us. We pray that you will be with the local church as well as the regional and church globally, that your message might be spread. We pray that you will bless our project with the Habitat for Humanity, that we might continue to build this house for this deserving lady and her children. We thank you for the opportunity to do that. We pray for our government that the leaders might seek your wisdom and might make right decisions to help us to progress as we should. That you will be with the world leaders, that they also might seek to do a good job and make correct decisions that benefit all. Lord, we know there are so many that are sick and ill. We lift up those that were lifted up this morning and those on our prayer list. Those that we know of that are not mentioned. Be with them that they might feel your healing power. They might feel your peace. May we always seek to bring comfort to those who are hurting and need your comfort. God, we know there are so many times that we fall short of what you want us to do, where we fail to do the things we know we should do, where we just simply don't hear the nudges that you give us to say something kind. Forgive us and help us to seek to serve you in all ways and to be kind to our neighbors. We seek your guidance in all ways, we might live as you would want us to live, that we might show forth the great love that you've given to us, that we might share the message of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and to be forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and
great blessings that we are able to share. May the gifts be used in accordance with your will. Bless them and the giver. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Hebrews, the fourth chapter, verses 12 through 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And therefore, before we have no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of it. One to whom we must tender an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy. By grace to God in time of need. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of this
word. It's a joy to be with you today to bring you greetings on behalf of Bill because it was a privilege to be asked by him to do this, and also to bring you greetings as a regional elder, because I am one of the volunteer regional elders for the Christian Church in Indiana, serving as a connection sort of between the regional office in Indianapolis and local congregations. So it's just good to be with you. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews is comparing the word of God to a sharp with a dog knife. You take a beautiful homegrown tomato that's perfect for your BLT, and you try to cut nice, even slices with a dog knife. If you're like me, you're either going to get chunks or tomato mush. Our son gave us a new set of knives for Christmas a couple of years ago, and I discovered how well a really sharp knife can cut. And now we have tomato slices instead of chunks, and I can even dice grapes for chicken salad. Sharp knives cut cleanly. They have also hurt you. I picked up several of our knives the other day at one time so that I could hold them under the faucet and rinse them. And before I knew it, my finger was bleeding. Just so, sometimes God's word cuts sharply and nicks our conscience. What does the writer mean? The word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. The word of God is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Sometimes that can hurt. Let's unpack this image just a bit. First of all, what is the word of God? Is it the Bible, the scriptures that have been handed down through the generations? Is it the law and the prophets? Is it the gospels or the letters of Paul? In John's gospel, we read, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. The logos, the word, is it Jesus? The word of God comes to us in many ways. It comes through Jesus, who we know as God's Son and as the living word. comes through the working of the Holy Spirit, which can speak through scripture as well as through preaching and teaching. The writer says, the word of God is living and active. So God is still speaking today. Perhaps God speaks in our interactions with each other. Perhaps in our dreams. Maybe even when we're walking in the woods. When we visited Upper Michigan last week, we hiked through amazingly beautiful woods, stood on the shores of three of the Great Lakes, and saw some sparkling clear waterfalls. Was I perhaps hearing the word of God at that time in some way? And active, it can judge the thoughts and intentions. Biblical scholar Jesper Skarthek points out that the word here translated as judge is a Greek word, kritikos. He says this word only occurs once in the New Testament, here in this passage in Hebrews. He tells us that, regrettably, many Christians have been taught that in an encounter with God, there's nothing but divine condemnation. And there are Greek words that mean condemnation, but those are not the words used here by the writer of Hebrews. He says, kritikos is probably closer in meaning to what critics do when writing about literature or art. They do not put the pen to paper in order to disapprove. They do it to sift what is good from what they believe is not as good. The root of kritikos is a verb which means to distinguish, to separate. This is what critics do. They discern what is good. So maybe that means that one of the most important functions of the Word of God is to help us distinguish what really matters in life and what merely seems to matter. God's Word is able to judge, to distinguish and separate the thoughts and intentions of our hearts. It cuts through our pretenses. It's able to discern and sort what we really think and feel. Does it really matter, for example, what color we paint the sanctuary? I've known a congregation who thought it did and who fought over it. Or does it really matter where the family goes for vacation? Is it maybe more important to focus on the people who are enjoying their time just being together somewhere? Does it really matter that the person standing in line in front of us at the grocery store using food stamps to buy milk and eggs is holding an iPhone 10? Or is it maybe more important to focus on my own life and priorities than to judge someone else's? What really matters in this life? The gospel reading for today comes from Mark's gospel, and it's a story that we've all heard many times. A rich young man comes to Jesus and asks, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" In other words, he's asking, what is really important? We know this story. Jesus reminds him to obey all the commandments. And the young man says that he's been doing that his entire life. But then Jesus gives him a hard answer. loving gaze of Jesus penetrates to the heart. Jesus is the living and active Word of God, whose gaze, like a scalpel, dissects bone from marrow. His winnowing fork separates wheat from chaff. His love sees clearly and speaks truthfully. And thank you for this. The challenge that I hear in this passage from Hebrews is similar. God's living word calls us to more than an intellectual understanding, more than just believing some good words about Jesus. God's living word challenges us to the actual doing of Christ-like actions in every part of our daily lives. This is not because we will somehow gain salvation by what we do, but it's because our actions can be a witness to the empowering grace given by God. Because the rest of our passage says that we have a high priest, Jesus, has suffered and been tested in every way like us. What I think is important for us is to know that Jesus, God's very Son, knows what it's like to be human. As an old favorite hymn says, Jesus knows our every weakness. And that means that we can approach the throne of grace. This means that we do our best in our daily lives. Martin Luther is often quoted as saying, love God and sin boldly. In context, what he was saying is that we will never be perfect. We will commit sins, for this life is not a place where justice resides. But if our love for God and our desire to follow Jesus our guiding force, we can, as the writer of Hebrews says, approach the throne of grace and find mercy and forgiveness there. The prophet Micah reminds us what God requires of us. God does not want great sacrifices or tremendous suffering or even perfection on our part. The prophet says, he has told you, O mortal, what is good. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? How do we do justice and love kindness in our everyday lives? For some, it's a choice to volunteer at a someone may choose to mow their neighbor's grass or write letters and cards to people who are hurting or get the COVID vaccine or collect supplies for the refugees from Afghanistan who are currently being housed in Camp Atterbury. Whatever we choose, we know it is hard to follow Jesus. The word can pierce like a knife and convict us. It's sharp. Gene Peterson in The Message uses the metaphor of a surgeon's scalpel. He says it this way. God's powerful word is sharp as a surgeon's scalpel, cutting through everything, whether doubt or defense, laying us open to listen and obey. Nothing and no one can resist God's word. The promise in the second part of our we know who Jesus is. We know that he was tempted just like we are tempted. We know that he needed help during his earthly life. We also know that he was killed on the cross, that after he was killed on the cross, he rose from the dead we know that we can come to Him on that throne with confidence. And this means that when we are struggling with the decision to do the right thing, that we're not sure we really want to do, God is there helping us in that struggle. If we try to live by what we say we believe, we can challenge our friends at the breakfast table when they start to tell blonde jokes or share belittling gossip about another church member. We can stand up for the person who is being bullied. We can choose to do what is right, even when that is not easy. Jesus has been there, as Eugene Peterson says. He's been through weakness and testing and has experienced it all. We can walk right up to Him and get what He is so ready to give. Take the mercy, accept the help. There's a sense in which, as we gather around the communion table, we are approaching the throne of grace on which our Savior sits. We come here with confidence, with boldness, because we know that here we are accepted and loved and forgiven. This is good news in spite of everything we do or don't do, in spite of all the times that we fail and fall short. Christ still offers us bread and wine of salvation and hope. So let us approach with boldness, as the writer of Hebrews says, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Amen. Our communion hymn is number 528, Give Thanks. He took the cup, and again, he gave thanks and gave it to them, saying,
We're thankful that you sent your son to die on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. We know that you forgive us. Help us to forgive ourselves that we might go forth and share your love. We remember these things as we take these elements. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's partake together. And our closing gift is number 475, the title is thank you.